left, I was teaching out at Rio Grande High School, and a former professor of mine at UNM asked me to join him on this grant that he had received, working with school districts in northern and central New Mexico. Anyway, when I left, I fully intended to come back to the public schools, because I was working on my master's degree in school administration. At that time, my long-term ambition was to become a high school principal. I had worked there at Rio Grande. I had also been the activities director and worked very closely with the principal. I thought that would be a lot of fun. I mean, I worked with a very good principal, and he was a good role model for me. And so I fully intended to come back, and then when I came to work at UNM, I also became active with the LULACs, the League of United Latin American Citizens, and I was their second president after they had organized here in Albuquerque. And one of our goals was to get involved and more involved in education, on the policy side of education. And somebody noted that there had never been a Hispanic on the school board. Somebody had done the research. I didn't know that. I just assumed it maybe at some point. But in what we know today as the Albuquerque City School Board, there had never been a Hispanic. So we felt it was important that we have a Hispanic voice. So we went around trying to recruit somebody. We talked to her. We made contact with every prominent Hispanic businessman. You know, we had this thing in our mind. He or she, mostly he, had to be a business person, had to be somebody that kind of conservative, because we just used the model of what we perceived a school board member to be like. You know? And we went around for months looking for somebody, and anybody who was interested in politics would tell me, "You're crazy. Being on a school board, if you want to end your career in politics, join the school board, because like city council, you know, you don't make any friends being on there." So we couldn't find anybody. So somebody said, "Well, Ted, you're the one that knows the most about this now, because we had done a lot of research, and maybe you ought to run." And I wasn't sure why I'd do that, because you can't be principal of a high school in Albuquerque if you're on the school board. You know, you're their boss, and you probably would give up a career there. So I thought about it, and I said, "Gosh, that seemed like a challenge to be the first one." And there's no organization. You don't have a political party. You don't have, you know, anything, any structure for how you run for the school board. So we kind of had to invent one. In those days, school board members ran at large, meaning that you ran in the whole city, and Rio Rancho and Corrales. That's your school system. So everybody ran at large. Voter turnouts are low, most every board member that I ever knew had been a business person, and they were the prominent members of the community, the ones that you read about that are, you know, with the banks or something or another like that. So it wasn't your typical Democrat, Republican kind of politician. So how do you get? And they already have a built-in system, because they belong to the Rotary Club, the Chamber of Commerce, and they're already well known. And the business community at that time, and still does, plays a big role in education. Schools are, you know, not only do building of schools and all that goes with that, the infrastructure of school is a big business, but schools generate a lot of business for the community, and so trying to organize around that was a challenge. So I just decided to just go I started with teachers. That was a natural for me, because I knew the leadership of the teachers' organizations. I knew some of the PTA people. So then about that time, being a member of the LULAC, we had contacts with neighborhood associations. They were relatively new. I mean, most neighborhood associations started in 64. This is 68, this is 4 years later. And other organizations, League of Women Voters, I knew some of the members of that, or I was introduced to some of these people. And just every day for about 6 months, that's what I did. I had an organization. Then one of the things that I did, which I thought was masterful, was try to find a very influential business person who would support me. Somebody that the business community recognized, not that the folks at large recognized, but in the business community. And I just happened to have been lucky enough to have known a gentleman by the name of John Raskob. Mr. Raskob was, his family has a foundation still exists, that supports Catholic education and Catholic colleges around the United States. You go in his office and he's got a doctorate, he had a doctorate degree from, honorary doctorate from every Catholic university and college and probably in the world. And the reason I had known him is when I was in college, I had been president of the Newman Club. And Mr. Raskob had given the Newman Club $250,000, which in those days was one hell of a lot of money. It's like somebody giving you several million today to build the chapel. And I was president when that was done. And Mr. Raskob gave me, I have a picture somewhere, I was holding the big check that they gave me and Father Butler, Father Richard Butler, who my son is named after. And anyway, but I knew Mr. Raskob, and I used to run into him at the Newman Center every so often. We'd often talk, very quiet man. Never read about you, never saw his name in the paper. So I went over and told him, I'm interested in running for the school board. And I said, I know this is not something that it's, you know, in maybe something that you've never thought of. But his family were converts. They're converts to Catholicism. And I said to him, you know that 60 to 70% of, or more, of the children that attend the public schools are Catholic. And yet, the Catholic leaders of this community put all their emphasis in Catholic education, Catholic schools, parochial schools. And the fact of the matter is that most Catholic children cannot afford or don't go to Catholic schools. And they're the poorest. And I think that turned him on. So he said, after we talked a while, he said, well, what can I do for you? I said, what I would like for you to do is get a group of top businessmen to meet me and talk and get him to support me. And he said, fine. And he did. He had a couple of dinners for me. He invited people that I would have never been able to get into their office in the time that I had to meet me and talk to me, and they liked me. And I think that helped me. If nothing else, it neutralized anybody that they might put up, because the business community always put up candidates. They wouldn't call themselves, we are the business, but there was kind of a, if you went to a Rotary Club meeting, I found this a year later, my theory was correct. You go to a Rotary Club meeting, or you went to a Kiwanis meeting, or you went to any of these big clubs, they were non-political organizations, but come school board time, they remind you of a school board election, and usually somebody just happened to bring a guest. who happened to be the person they were most likely to vote for a school board. Like, and that's what they did for me. As a matter of fact, I had an interesting experience. There was a gentleman, an attorney, Hispanic, old-time attorney, that when I was a paper boy, none of us wanted to sell him a paper because he would give you 7 cents. Papers were 7 cents. The journal was 7 cents, and you depended on them giving you a dime, and you got to keep the 3 cents. Well, this guy would wait for his change, and nobody wanted to ever wanted to sell him a paper. You see Mr. Espinosa coming down the road. He was a little guy, Gilbert Espinosa, historian, well-known lawyer. And we would all run away from him because so one day he ran into my dad, he knew my dad, and he said, "Is Delano still selling papers?" And my dad said, "Yeah, sure he is." He says, "Well, have him do something for me. Have him go up to the top floor of the Sunshine Building and have him bring me a paper, and we'll buy our paper from him." So my dad said, "Gilberto, Mr. Espinosa wants you to take a newspaper up to his office. I got you a customer," that's what my dad said. And I said, "Who's that?" He says, "Gilberto Espinosa." I said, "Dad, we run away from him. He will only give us 7 cents." So I said, "Well, but you know, he's a good man, he's a good person. Who knows, someday, you know, that." He said, "When you do something like that, someday it'll pay off for you." Something like that. And so I would go dutifully when I was a little boy, you know, and deliver my paper to him. He'd give me 7 cents. His secretary would count out the 7, a nickel and 2 pennies. And, you know, I'd lose 3 cents, but, well, you know, that's life. Well, 20 years later, I'm running for the school board. Mr. Espinosa, there was a gentleman who was a former state senator by the name of Ginn, who was Leonard Ginn, who knew me through my dad, and he invited me he wanted to take me to the Kiwanis, I think it was Kiwanis Club, to introduce me when I was running for the school board. So I went with him, and there were about 300 men out there. I don't know if you've ever been to one of these Kiwanis or Rotary meetings, but you know what they're like. Mr. Leonard Ginn, you know, got up and told the crowd, you know, that he had known me since I was a little boy, and what a great guy I was, and all the things that people who are promoting you are supposed to say. And then out of the back of the crowd, this little old man raises his hand, and he gets up to the front, and he says, "I have known Teodorito since he was about 10 years old." And he says, very resourceful. He was a paper boy right down the street over here. He sold papers every day. And he said, "He'd go up to my office, and he would deliver a paper in my office." He said, "I'll tell you what, I never saw a young man who was as ambitious, and I knew since he was that young that he would be somebody someday." Boy, I tell you what, that was the best endorsement. I told my dad afterwards, and see, it paid off. So that, and he was, Gilberto Espinosa was the son-in-law, the brother-in-law of Dennis Chavez. So, and he was a, he was a well-known kind of amateur historian here in Albuquerque. You know, he always gave talks on New Mexico history. His wife was real tall and he was real short, and he always wore a little bow tie, always very formally dressed, you know. But nice man. Anyway, going back to, so the election was just based on a lot of shoe leather and talking to people and being available to people no matter what the size was, and then telephone calls we made. I can still remember how much money I spent. I raised $400 and spent $300 on my first campaign. And it was all on a mail out. We just did a mail out. We just sent a mail out to just a letter. It wasn't fancy brochures like they do nowadays. My next for re-election, I think I spent $800. And again, there was a couple of mail outs. Today for one running for the school board on 1/7 of the district, I have heard school board members spend as much as $15,000 to run for an office that doesn't pay you anything. Well, nowadays they get per diem, but we didn't get anything. But that's beside the point. Even if you get per diem, it's not very much money for the time that you put into it, because it is time consuming and it is demanding and it's tough. I was reading about the school board member this morning being getting it almost into a shoving match with some guy who was trying to take pictures of her. We had my truck almost firebombed in front of my driveway when I was on the school board. And it was during a time when we were moving a lot of boundaries around. And some parents get really angry at you. Some people get crazy, you know, there are crazy people out there.
So what do you feel you accomplished being on the school board? You served for 2 terms?
Right.
Are they 4-year terms?
They're 6-year.
6-year terms.
I think the major accomplishment at that time is that we began to establish alternative type of school programs that some still exist today. Freedom High School, School on Wheels, what is a school for pregnant teenagers? New Futures. Just to give you an example of how different things were, when I tell people these stories, they say they couldn't happen only 30, 40 years ago. When I was on the, when I got, at the time that I joined the school board and the time that I was first went into education, if a young girl got pregnant, and the minute it was found out that she was pregnant, she was expelled.
Yeah.
Period. No questions asked. She was expelled. And the only way she could get in, if she had to apply to get back in, and it had to get the approval of the girl's physician and the principal with a statement that it was possible to rehabilitate her. That was exactly in the language. In other words, there's a good chance. No, they didn't want girls that had babies going to school. I mean, that was an automatic. So the first thing that we had to do was to change the language. We started New Futures. We started a New Futures school, but we did 2 things, and I don't take credit for this. I give this credit to a fellow school board member, Hank Willis, who said, we're not going to set up a separate but equal for girls that are pregnant. We'll set up a program that will help young girls that want to go to these programs, be in this program, because they'll get a lot of supportive services. But why should they come back to their home high school? And so we had to change the language of saying that as long as, you know, the girl wanted to go back to school, she went back to school, no questions asked. It didn't matter whether she had a baby or not at home. That wasn't the business of school. In some of the schools at that time, in some of the schools they had child, I can't remember, I knew Rio Grande had one. They had they would just be there for 2-3 hours just so that the students could learn how to change a baby and do all these other things. It was more of a, it was a home economics class what it was. And some of the girls, that was sort of the beginning of doing that. And, you know, that was a real breakthrough when you think about it. Maybe today it doesn't seem like much, but in that day it was a lot because we had a lot of opposition. You'd be surprised with parents, the letters that we got complaining from parents saying that, you know, we're going to make the school system immoral. Reminds you of the battle we're having on gay rights today. It's like, where have I heard this, seen this picture before, you know, or heard this language about all of that? I mean, but, you know, that's not new. You always have somebody's, you know, schools are particularly hard to change because because there are those institutions, schools tend to impact everybody in some way or another, so they're a lot tougher to change.
Yeah. Oh, that's beautiful.
But that was a great time because so many other things are happening. You know, you had the war in Vietnam. People were challenging the war in Vietnam. That never happened in that scale. There was a war on poverty. There was just all kinds of social, I won't call it upheaval, but a lot of dynamics going on that was possible to do things that the methadone maintenance programming, that would have, if you'd have tried that 5 years before, you would have never gotten off the ground. Sure, it was controversial, remained controversial, but it still happened, you know. Mm-hmm.